Here is a 58-year-old man presented with chief complaints of left flank pain since 1 to 2 years and bilateral pedal edema since 1 to 2 months.
I would like to know about the character of the pain and any medication history for the pain. What is the
pain is gradual in onset, intermittent, dull aching, non-radiating, not requiring analgesic, with no aggravating or relieving factors, and bilateral pedal edema is present.
Yeah, I want to know whether the patient has got any fullness in his abdomen, any fullness in his loin.
Yes, he feels some fullness in the left flank region.
Any history of hematuria, fever?
He had a history of hematuria, which was gross, total painless, and occasionally associated with few clots, not associated with tissue bits, and not requiring blood transfusion or admission. But this episode were before 1 year, and it lasted about a week. He took some Ayurvedic medications, but had no relief. However, it resolved spontaneously.
You consulted any allopathic doctor for this evaluation?
No.
Any investigations done?
No, he does not have any records. He just took some Ayurvedic medication, and he hematuria was resolved, so he left it out.
Any history of previous surgery?
No, no history of previous surgery.
What's the other symptom this patient has?
So only pain and lower limb edema, 2 1-month durations.
You don't want to inquire about the lower limb edema. Are you coming to it?
Yeah, coming to it. Since the pain is for 1 to 2 years and the edema is only for 1 month.
Hmm.
That's why I asked about any fullness in his loin or...
Right, we know that.
Yeah.
No, which side is more painful?
Huh? Left side.
Left is more than the right.
Hmm.
Pain is by left.
Equal. So what can be the reason for bilateral flank pain? At this age,
is it bilateral?
Left,
only left,
left
side.
Left loin.
Only left loin, I thought.
Okay, left loin. I think I heard bilateral. Okay, left loin. And fullness and history of hematuria. And fetal. All suggested malignancy of renal. Maybe. Adrenal malignancy also we can assume with venous involvement because of the bilateral pedal edema.
You suspect malignancy of renal origin causing bilateral pedal edema.
With involvement of venous systems.
Okay. And what other symptoms do you need to ask?
I don't know about any abdominal fullness or breathing difficulty or any new onset varicocele which does not decompress on lying down.
The patient may not know this term varicocele.
What did you ask him?
Complaining of scrotal fullness, sir.
Edema.
Painful or painless, and fitting or non-fitting, and any dilated veins over the abdominal wall.
What do you ask the patient?
When he lies down, whether it's decompressing or not.
Right. So, okay.
The pedal edema is painless, fitting, and it does not resolve on lying down.
Does he take any medication for the pedal edema? For any?
No, no, he has not taken any medication. He has come with this chief complaint.
So apart from, you said that it could be advanced, right? You said it could be advanced, the renal malignancy, which is your first diagnosis. Any other reason why people with malignancy will have bilateral pedal edema?
Ma'am, I couldn't get it.
Bilateral, right? It is left-sided renal pain.
Yes, ma'am.
So what are the other causes?
What are the other causes of bilateral pedal edema in somebody who's got a left loin pain with hematuria? One, you said yes, something about venous involvement.
Even bulky lymph nodes can cause some.
Bulky lymph nodes, yes. Bulky lymph nodes, bilateral pedal edema.
If you are saying it is due to the renal malignancy, then it has to involve...
What other effects would somebody have to cause edema if he's been having hematuria on and off and symptoms in the left loin for nearly 2 years? And he has never bothered to take any treatment because the hematuria was self-limiting. It doesn't have... What other reason could be there apart from the fact that he has got venous involvement? Which as a urologist, you're okay, yeah, you should consider that. But, you know, as a doctor, you have to consider so many other things. What could be another reason for bilateral pedal edema?
Considering age, blood salts are your doctor.
Let's.
LUTS also.
How will that give rise to bilateral pedal edema?
If at all, this prostatic obstruction is there. But if no history of any LUTS is given.
Yeah, no history of any LUTS. Bilateral pedal edema and LUTS, unless he's got retention. Sometimes you get there. Or you've got a malignancy in the prostate also.
Yeah, but something simple which we see on a daily
basis. Simple thing we see. Going on, chronic illness.
Cardiac issues.
Cardiac issues secondary to?
Liver failure.
Or
chronic kidney failure.
You can relate to this condition. What can this condition produce if it's going on for 2 years to cause edema?
Any venous embolism?
No, simple. Man. You're not asking fancy questions.
Hypoproteinemia,
right. Anything else before hypoproteinemia? What is the common feature of renal malignancy which goes undetected?
Anemia.
Anemia itself can give rise to pressure. You know, don't absolve yourself of thinking of medical conditions. You may not have venous thrombus or whatever it is. Okay,
what else in relation? Now you're suspecting malignancy. No other differential you think of because it's going on for 2 years.
Why is it that renal malignancy goes on for such a long time? 2 years is going on, right?
It's just 1 to 2 years.
Whatever, 1 to 2 years, maximum 1 to 2 years. It gives you a full range. You ask the patient how many years? 1 to 2 years. You know how pain, very difficult suddenly if you ask the history. Very difficult to remember when it is hard and step, you know. So 1 to 2 years you give an andaz figure. So 2 years. Why is it that this so-called renal malignancy is going on for 2 years?
Without producing any obstruction to the pelvic system.
Correct, it's not producing. So why is it going on for 2 years? What is it? What is so peculiar about renal cancer that goes on and on like this?
The histology variant maybe.
Not histology, man. Not histology at all. Simple thing, man. The location of the kidney, the location of the tumor vis-a-vis the kidney. Most of these malignancies are exophytic. They grow outwards and they go on and on and on slowly. Yeah? They push the abdomen anteriorly. There is nothing posteriorly because it's all muscle. So it will grow about and grow. So it's well known to get this, you know, go on and on slowly. So the fact that the kidney is a retroperitoneal structure by itself is covered by perinephric fat. Yeah? So all these are reasons why. Yeah, disease like this can go on and on. And after a point in time, it erodes both outwards and inwards, involves the pelvic health system, there are veins over, they bleed and they give rise to hematuria. Then the veins will stop bleeding, they stop prematurely. Some clot will form, that will also come down and stop. Ultimately, all bleeding of this nature is self-limiting unless it erodes into a vessel. Duodenal ulcer bleed, erode into a vessel, aortic bleed. So, big vessel, then only. Small things like vein, go on and on. So, what do you know?
We need to know the physical examinations.
Physical examination, okay.
You don't want to know about weight loss and other things. Anorexia.
History. Yes.
So there was history of fullness in left flank present. No history of fever or lithuria, pyuria, lower urinary tract symptoms or retention of urine. He had a history of anorexia and weight loss around 5 to 6 kgs in last 3 to 4 months. No history of cough, hemoptysis, bone pain. No history of decreased urine output, breathlessness or facial puffiness. He has no comorbidities and he has no allergy to any drug.
So, you forgot to ask about the metastatic symptoms, okay? Because you are suspecting malignancy, you need to ask about that.
Okay.
Yeah, he had bilateral pedal edema. And so, you could have asked whether he has edema elsewhere. And whether he has any features or history of CRF. Because it can be a single functioning kidney with renal malignancy, right?
Yes.
He is a chronic tobacco chewer for last 15 to 20 years.
Does tobacco predispose to renal malignancy?
Yes, ma'am.
In what way?
Tobacco in any form increases. Tobacco in any form increases the risk for malignancy, renal malignancy.
See, in bladder there are so many mechanisms. In kidney, are they there?
Same carcinogenic mutations only.
Is there any connection between tobacco, excretion of the so-called carcinogens in the urine? They can come into the bladder, they can come into the urine. Apart from that, does tobacco do something to HIF?
Hypoxia inducing factor.
No, no, sir. You got to know. You know, these are some of the mechanisms, that's what madam is asking. What is the connection between tobacco smoking and renal malignancy? Huh? The carcinogens are there in tobacco. Huh? Same mechanism that is there in the bladder, then you come in the bladder, there is storage. In the kidney, there is not much of storage for this carcinogens to act. But something else happened in the kidney and that's what madam wanted to know.
If you want to read about it, we'll discuss next time. Predisposing.
Yeah.
Okay.
10 minutes.
Okay. So his general exam is normal. You want to know anything specific in general exam?
Yes, ECOG is one. So I would like to know about Taylor and any other enrollment.
Sorry?
You can say this.
On general examination, would you like to know anything else? Apart from lymph nodes and all the rest of it?
Sensitivity average and the not much nutritional status.
Oh, right. Okay. What about abdominal examination?
Yeah, next.
So, per abdominal examination, on inspection, abdomen is asymmetrical in shape with a visible lump occupying left hypochondriac, left lumbar, left iliac fossa, epigastrium and umbilical region with a normal looking overlying surface with normal centrally placed umbilicus with no discoloration or dilated veins or any scar. On palpation, temperature is normal with no tenderness, a single palpable lump of approximately size 20 by 15 centimeter. Occupying left hypochondriac, left lumbar, left iliac fossa, epigastrium and umbilical region is present with ill-defined margins, a smooth overlying surface, mobile on respiration and ballotable, and finger insinuation below the costal margins is possible.
It's a large mass on the left side. It's almost opening the all the three quadrants.
He's given a K Das description of a real lump. Except knee elbow position, huh?
And we have missed.
I'd like to know the check.
What have we missed?
I'd like to know the spine examination and the genital examination. Also.
Spine and genitalia. Okay.
Whether this lump is hard or stable. Consistency is not an issue. Anyway, okay.
On local further examination, external urethral meatus is normal, diffuse pen is normal, scrotum bilateral testes are normal with grade 3 varicocele on left side. On digital rectal examination, perianal sensations are present, anal tone is normal with prostate grade 1, no nodularity.
What do you want to know about the varicocele?
Whether it decomposes left and most. Whether it decomposes on lying down or...
No, it doesn't decompress on lying down.
So what could be the reason why this varicocele doesn't decompress on lying down?
And the IVC obstruction, sir.
IVC obstruction. This is on the left side, no?
Bilateral.
No, left side varicocele.
Oh, only left renal.
So what is the reason?
That means left renal vein, where it's joined, where coronal vein joining with left renal vein, that may be there.
Is what?
Obstruction.
Any other reason for this varicose?
If it's not decompressing, it may be the normal physiological thing also.
No, it's not decompressing. Any other reason? Does it have to be a clot? Does it have to be a thrombus in the renal vein? There must be a thrombus in the renal vein to obstruct the drainage of the gonadal vein inside. Any other reason? There is no clot.
Lymph nodes in.
Why will the lymph nodes give rise to varicocele?
Pelvic masses can give rise to.
No, it's not pelvic, it's a big mass there. Left loin mass. What's the other reason why this mass is giving rise to varicocele? There is no tumor. Can you just look at the size of this mass?
The size of the tumor that's kinking.
No, just pressure. Just pressure on the gonadal vein. It's one thin structure there. You just sit on it. Huh? So there may be no thrombus, but just the pressure effect on the of the mass on the gonadal vein is going to give rise to the varicocele. Huh?
Okay, so what would you like to do?
I'd like to do the basic blood investigations like hemoglobin, proteins, creatinine.
Proteins where? Elective?
Yes, ma'am. Creatinine on urine examination.
Okay, albumin is nil.
RBC is 10 to 15. Hemoglobin is 9.2, creatinine is 1.4.
Okay.
Next.
So what do you do now? Think carefully before you answer.
So my first diagnosis is
No. What will you do now? Obviously, you've got a big mass in the in that area.
Yes.
And with hematuria and mass and pain, what is your diagnosis?
Sir, I would like to say left renal malignancy.
Yeah, malignancy. Full stop. I mean, everybody knows, starting from Hamilton Bailey. Loin pain, mass, hematuria, triad of renal cancer. Full stop. All the other conditions will fall by the wayside. This is the most important condition. Right. So what do you do now?
I would like to do a CT of the abdomen and pelvis along with CT of chest.
CT of the abdomen and pelvis?
No, chest also.
With contrast or without contrast?
With contrast. Create is 1.4.
Okay. What will you tell the radiologist?
Since we have in mind...
What instruction will you give to the radiologist?
So since we have in mind regarding the venous involvement,
yes.
So we'd like to see the venous face, arterial face, and the...
What could be a problem? The radiologist will tell you. What could be a problem in a situation like this that you are not able to get what you want? What do you want to know?
Extent of the tumor and...
extent of the tumor, that he'll tell you. What else do you want to know?
Venous involvement also.
Venous involvement. What is the problem with this venous involvement? What
the
could be...
The mass is so big, so it can would have pushed the tumor to the... Even the vasculature would be pushed and distorted.
No, no. What could be a technical difficulty in this situation like this, when there is a large mass and you give contrast? Or renal malignancy generally vascular or avascular?
Vascular.
They are usually vascular. So what happens in the arterial phase?
They enhance.
Huh?
They enhance.
They enhance. And then what will happen?
Then they will excrete.
Comes the arterial phase, excrete. Hmm. And if the vascular tumor, then what will happen?
If it is so vascular, it will, the washout will be very soaked, actually.
So? So what? You may not be able to see sometimes because the circulation goes off. So in that situation, what will you do? You will have to take delayed phases. The washout can be so rapid sometimes that when you give the contrast, it goes into the venous system. And if you are lucky, so you need to tell the radiologist, this is what I feel, suspect. Now, if there is a block, if there is a block in the renal vein, what will happen to the kidney? If there is a block in the renal vein, what could happen to the kidney due to thrombus?
Kidney will be enlarged.
Kidney will be enlarged. Anything else could happen to the kidney? If there is a block in the renal vein.
Even the function of the kidney will...
Function of the kidney will be?
Coming down.
Then what will happen?
There will be no excretions.
There will be no excretion. Function of the kidney is poor. So these are the situations, these are things that will, even contrast is going in, you see one mass, function is poor, you don't know what, whether it's excreting or not excreting. So it is important to know that these are the problems that you could face in interpreting such an X-ray.
What is one more condition where immediately the contrast appears in the renal vein, in the arterial phase?
Any AV fistula, ma'am.
So where do these AV fistula happen?
Within the tumor, ma'am.
In the tumor, ma'am?
Within the tumor.
They are not between the major vessels of the kidney?
Usually it occurs within the tumor.
Okay. What is one more disadvantage of the CT scan for a renal malignancy detecting AV involvement? Or renal vein involvement. Is it the best investigation?
No, MRI is the gold standard. Yes. Mm-hmm. But the current CT technology, they say both are equally efficacious.
So what is the problem in evaluating the venous outlet, the venous system? What problem happens exactly? What's the exact problem? You can't see the thrombus, or you can see some information which you would like to know.
The vein wall involvement we can't know.
In?
Vein wall involvement in CT, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anything else? When there is a suspected IVC thrombus, what are you interested in? The most important feature?
Enlargement of the vein and sudden change in size of the caliber and the collaterals.
No, no, no. Madam is not asking what are the findings. Oh. She wants to know what is the important question that you will ask or in your mind will first, as to when there is a thrombus in the renal vein, what do you want to know about that thrombus? What does it do to the vein?
So bland or tumor thrombus?
Well, bland or tumor thrombus, number one. Number two? More important than that? Do you want to know extent?
Yes.
How far it is going? It's very important to know that, no? Is it level 1 thrombus, 2, 3, 4? So,
extent of the thrombus, involvement of the hepatic veins, and this information is a little difficult to get exactly on a
CT scan.
So you want a CT scan or you want an MRI?
Given choice.
Now in the exam, when you are faced with a question like this, now do you want a CT scan or MRI? You must take the cue. After all this discussion, all the vein wall, this, that, everything, don't go, again go and say CT scan. I think I will go for MRI because I can see some of these features. I'll be able to see the vein better. I can be able to make an assessment.
And for all you know, the MRI won't be done. So it's good you can sit MRI.
Sure.
What do
you have?
Even I don't know what
it is. They don't tell me the plan, they test me.
Anyway, show the
imaging. This is the plain
Okay, show us the one with the contrast.
Yes, sir. This is the arterial phase. This is the venous phase.
Plain and arterial venous vessels seen. The right kidney appears normal. There is in the left renal region, there's a large heterogeneous mass, almost occupying all the quadrants. The renal cell, the renal contour is not seen on the left side. And even the great vessels are pushed to the opposite side. In the arterial phase, can see a heterogeneous CNS lesion in the left renal. The right is normal. The left renal, the separate renal, separate left kidney is not seen. It's a big, huge mass is there with enhancing lesion. There are areas of also.
You're saying it's not the kidney.
You couldn't see the separate kidney.
Show that picture again, please. Show the contour, artery, the phase. You can make out the spleen, no?
Spleen is the
spleen. Yes, you can make out the spleen.
Yes, sir, it's coming just 1 minute.
So you tell me in the meanwhile.
Yeah.
It's artery phase, it shows enhancing lesion with areas of hypodense. Small areas of hypodense, cetogenous enhancing lesions.
Okay. So the size you said is huge. So you want to comment on anything else? Something which is very, very prominently noticed?
The great vessels are actually pushed, sir. It's not in the... Okay. Comes up to the mass, comes up to the midline, even crosses the midline.
Okay, cross the midline. All that is agreed.
What is happening inside the mass? Can you see big channels?
Yes, there are areas of hypodense lesions also, big channels.
No, no, this is hypodensity. Is there necrosis?
More than hypodensity, it is a lot of vascularity.
How much of lakes of contrast just pooling there, sand hanging around there? See if there are any vessels, neovascularization within the tumor, outside of the lesion, AV communication, aneurysms, all these things will happen. And of course, necrosis. When you use the word heterogeneous, automatically it means that there is areas of necrosis. The necrosis is a radiological sign qua non of malignancy in the mass.
So what on the venous phase have you noticed? Venous phase, what have you noticed?
Venous phase, I couldn't see the enhancement of the IVC. So there's a...
Why should you see enhancement of the IVC? You mean to say the contrast is not seen in the IVC?
The IVC...
Okay, see again. Here you can see some contrast is coming in the IVC. Yeah, you can see contrast. So what is happening exactly? Now what is happening?
The lumen is not clearly seen and some probably clot is there.
Okay, I continue to see and now tell me the finding at the end of this film. What's happening here? What's this?
Even it extends to the...
That's the very Those are the dilated veins. What about the IVC? Is it enlarged? Is it normal in size? Is it in the same position where it should be there?
It is pushed to the right, ma'am, and even the lumen is not clearly seen. It's probably thrombus is there.
Lumen is not.
No, can you see in the cut on the right side? Can you see an IVC? Can you see an aorta? This is the thorax, isn't it? It is the thorax, isn't it? The lower cuts, isn't it?
Yes, lower.
So now you tell us.
You see the liver? You see a bit of the liver?
The liver was just coming.
You see, no, this one on the right side.
Just coming down.
Okay. No. You see, the aorta is here.
Yes.
Okay. You see what is the structure there next to it. Go up with that arrow. See that? This is going up. The IVC. What is important to know is at what level of this cut. Look at that.
From the liver, it's coming.
Yeah.
It's all big lump there. It's a wide dilated IVC with
no contact.
Is there a filling defect inside it?
Yep, on some cuts we can see.
Yeah, there is.
Yes.
Into the wall of the IVC? Is it regular round?
It's not regular.
Okay.
It's filled up inside, but it's not its usual. Elliptical. It's become more rounded. That's the problem. IVC is not round.
So wide.
On cuts, it's all over elliptical. So when it becomes round, it means it's fuller. And it's elliptical because the walls move with respiration. Alright? But when it becomes full, it's full. It doesn't move. And this is where it is difficult to make out whether the wall is not moving because it's full or whether the wall is infiltrated. And this is where sometimes the Doppler ultrasound may be better, or even an MRI may be better.
Okay, now we'll follow this IVC below the kidney, okay? Just check the comment.
See, there you can see the IVC in this cut, yes, keep following it up.
What is happening now?
Now it is coming more towards the...
Yeah, but why is it not filled with contrast?
No, we are coming below the kidney, ma'am. So, the thrombus between...
Should have contrast. It doesn't know. Contrast doesn't come only from the left renal vein. It will come from the lower limbs, right? So yes, it is not filled with contrast. So what can be your inference? Okay, go down.
In this tumor, does anything prevent this tumor from only going in one direction? If it is a thrombus?
Can go both caudally also.
It can go caudally also. What else can it do? Can it block the ostium of the other side?
So isn't that important to know?
If it is blocking the ostium of the normal kidney, it is jamming the system. Nothing is going. It's not seeing a
person. In this film, you can see that the iliac veins are getting full.
Yes.
Above it. And IVC is not filled with contrast.
Oh.
It should be, right? Why should it not? Whatever blood is going through the aorta, it has to come back.
Oh.
So superior level you could appreciate?
Yeah, it's almost below the liver, ma'am. Just.
Oh. And inferior level?
Inferior level is up to the just below the renal bifurcation.
And is the right renal vein involved?
No, ma'am.
Okay. I hope you notice the varicocele and you're noticing this dilated channel.
Yeah, this here with yes.
Okay. So, you need any more investigations? You're happy to manage him?
Yeah, we need a complete CT chest, ma'am.
Yeah, CT test was done. It is normal. There is no metastatic lesions.
There's one more question which I have and that I think you need to read about. Is what ways that the renal malignancy involves the...
Voice is not clear.
said next time you do two things.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, you find about the various methods in which renal malignancy metastasis to the lungs and the mediastinum and the chest.
Okay.
Okay. So now chest is normal. So what else do you want to do? You're confident it is a subhepatic level thrombus?
Only bit. That's what we need, a chest, and also sometimes we need a trans esophageal echocardiogram also.
No, for yep. subhepatic, how will be your diagnosis is that your thrombus is
subhepatic. Level 1 thrombus or what? Or level 2 thrombus?
Level 2. Below the hepatic veins. Level 2.
So it is intrahepatic, below the level of the hepatic veins.
Intrahepatic is level 3.
Below
the level is level 2. Yeah.
So it is subhepatic, right?
It's subhepatic.
Then for that, you think transesophageal echocardiography is a good investigation?
No, since you have done the CT chest, it's more sufficient.
We told you CT chest is normal. You said it is level 2 thrombus, and then you are asking for a transesophageal imaging.
But
why?
When you are close to the surgery, you have to again assess the for the extension.
That is not the answer to my question.
Transesophageal echocardiogram is going to assess the level of the thrombus within the thorax. Number one. Number two, it will assess whether the pulmonary arteries are involved with thrombus at all or not. Because these are important pathways. It's going into the heart and into the PA and then going across. Okay, so these are important considerations. And thirdly, it helps to continuously monitor in a patient who is being planned for IVC thrombectomy with or without bypass, whether all the tumor thrombus has been cleared. Full stop. That's it. So you must know that these are the reasons for doing a TEE.
Yeah, and not for a subhepatic thrombus.
Okay.
So you need any more investigations? You are happy? You want to tell us the management?
Already we have done all the investigations.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So there is no metastasis. It's a locally, locally advanced renal tube. So we will plan for a left radical nephrectomy plus level 2 to IVC thrombectomy.
How?
22,000 to 23,000.
Since it's a left side, we prefer a chevron incision.
But why are you saying left side? Since it is a left side, chevron incision. Chevron incision comes bilaterally, right?
Right. If it is a right-sided tumor, we can go with the midline incision. Since, but the left side, it's always preferable to go for a chevron incision. Because we need to place both the colons and the retroperitoneum. So it's for left-sided tumors, it's always chevron
incision. There is no such thing that for the left tumor this and for the right tumor do this. If you are planning to do a, it's a large mass. It's a large mass. And therefore, it's always better to do a chevron incision. If you are going to access the liver, if you're going to mobilize the liver and all the rest of it, and if you're going to have the Mercedes-Benz incision, then it's always better to do the chevron. The chevron gives you a more wider access, especially if you're going to do some form of liver mobilization. Alright? So a midline will restrict your movement, how much you will be able to separate. Alright? And this mass is so big that it's already made part of your incision by virtue of its size and pushing it. So therefore, you use the maximum diameter where in the chest, right across the chevron. It's a big mass, you need a big incision to make sure that you get the correct plane, you get everything sorted out. Otherwise, you'll be in deep trouble if you're trying to make small incisions and trying to struggle. It's a very big mass. Okay?
Any role for preoperative embolization?
There's, but it doesn't help in
how will preoperative embolization
reduce
the if they do want to carry it out, what is the best way of carrying it out?
It's artery embolization, but
what is the best way of doing it is? Seizure.
Dhamma
Will you embolize this by particles and gel foam and muscle, or will you do something else? And if you do embolization, when will you do the embolization? Today, tomorrow, day of surgery, 2 days before?
You have to be in advance, then only it will, the tumor will shrink.
What is the current strategy?
Currently, they say that preoperative embolization does not heal.
That I agree with you. Agreed. But there are some people who are diehard. They want to embolize. So for those fellows, what is it? What is the problem with embolization before the surgery?
It may cause any reaction.
Look at the size of this mass. So you can produce a lot of TNF and a lot of immune reaction, and you will get a SIRS. And that could delay your surgery because the patient will be quite febrile. So what is the better way of doing embolization, if at all you want to do it?
On table only you have to do it.
On table. So how will you do it on table?
So you have to do
You got a cardiac cath table, angiogram table or for operating or
what? For this we don't.
On the day of surgery, you put a catheter, occlude the renal, keep the thing there and don't occlude it, but keep the catheter in position, occlude the balloon at anesthesia so that you occlude the artery and reduce the blood flow. Alright? That is one way of doing it, not before, but doing it on the day of surgery so that you reduce the blood flow and are able to get the tumor. Control, blood vessels control.
Even other ways, we first control the renal arteries.
True, but you want to embolize, no? To get to the renal artery in a mass like this is not easy. It will be right behind somewhere. You will have to lift the whole tumor up. Alright? And before you reach that renal artery, you will have a lot of other problems. There is tumor thrombus in the renal vein. There will be a lot of collaterals. This is not going to be easy. You will lose a lot of blood before you reach the artery. Alright? You see what's happening to the artery, you can hardly see it in this, in these angiogram. Where all is going? So, a situation like this, you can jam the artery with the balloon on the day of surgery so that you reduce the circulation and this will facilitate your dissection. That's all. Sujata?
Yes, sir. Sorry, I was.
I have to go down.
Yes, sir.
You carry on with this. Just finishing, I think.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you, sir. Just 2 minutes, I'll join you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So yeah, sorry, I didn't pay attention to the last part. Yeah, but embolization would only help in controlling a bit of the blood loss because it's a very huge tumor, no? And you will not be able to go to the great vessels unless you do the nephrectomy first because there is no space.
Yes, ma'am.
We have to isolate the IVC. We have to look for the lumbar veins. We have to see whether they are going to need control because when you clamp the IVC, they will continue to bleed through the lumbar veins. So all these things you can't do in the presence of such a large mass. So once the artery is in your control, okay. Then you are relatively relaxed. Okay, it doesn't matter that artery is properly embolized. But the issue with embolization in such cases is it is not necessary that it becomes complete.
Yes, ma'am.
And the embolization agent, whatever you use, can sometimes move away into the kidney and you may not be sure that this has happened.
Okay,
and I think in such a big renal mass, you should also ask for alkaline phosphatase because there is possibility of bone metastasis.
Yes.
So that part you need to ask. Otherwise, I think they can ask you the techniques for IVC
What is the measures for removing an IVC thrombus? What are the methods of hepatic, yes. subhepatic,
yes, ma'am.
Suprahepatic? All these things you should know.
Oh.
Hmm? Okay.
Okay.
So, yeah, next time we'll discuss. Hmm?
Okay. Okay.
Bye.
Thank you.